Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Yang berbahagia, Datuk Profesor Dr. Adi Bakar Murzaman, Dekan Fakulti of Med, Dekan Fakulti Perubatan, all deputy deans, Yang berusaha Profesor Dr. Tunku Kamal Zaman, Director of University of Malaya Medical Center, all deputy directors, Professor Dr. Suresh Kumar, Head of Department, Department of Parastology, Faculty of Medicine, Yang berbahagia Tan Sri Professor Mustafa Babji, Distinguished Emeritus Professors, Datuk Professors, Fellows and Members of Academy of Sciences Malaysia, Honourable President, Council Members and Members of the Malaysian Society of Parastology and Tropical Medicine, Academicians and Colleagues, Honoured Guests, Ladies and Gentlemen, welcome to the inaugural lecture by Professor Dr. Yvonne Lim Ailian entitled Debunking the Myth about Gutworms by Unlocking the Secrets of Gut Microbiota. Without further delay, I would like to invite Datuk Professor Dr. Adi Bakar Murzaman to chair the lecture and introduce Professor Dr. Yvonne Lim Ailian. Dipersilakan.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Professor Yvonne Lim, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much and welcome to this afternoon's inaugural lecture for Professor Yvonne Lim, which is being held in conjunction with the fellowship lecture for the Academy of Sciences Malaysia. I think it's a measure of everyone's respect for Prof. Yvonne that we have a room that is almost full this afternoon, which can sometimes be unusual for this inaugural lecture. Professor Yvonne Lim obtained her BSc and PhD from Universiti Kebangsaan Malaysia. As you can see, she's wearing our rival university's gown this afternoon, and I said, Yvonne, maybe we won't let you give your inaugural lecture. But anyway, that's just a friendly joke. Of course, she's allowed to wear her hard-earned PhD gown from UKM. She chose to come to UM in 2003 and has been with us since, and since then has had a very distinguished career, both as an academician and now also as an administrator. Prior to joining us, she had spent some time first at UKM and then at Tunku Abdurrahman College, and has had the privilege of receiving training under distinguished professors Dr. Hugh Vaughan Smith in Glasgow, as well as Professor Robin Gazer at the Melbourne University. I think I can attest to this, that Yvonne loves teaching and enjoys research. She has been teaching parasitology to the medical, pharmacy, biomedical, and nursing and MLT students for the past 15 years. And recently, together with Prof. Rohela, published a book on medical parasitology, which was published by Springer. I think the term quiet achiever was originally coined for Yvonne, I'm pretty sure, because it's exactly who and what she is. Someone who has chosen to make a career out of decidedly unglamorous subject, I think, and that is of worms. I mean, I'm an infectious disease physician myself, but I think for someone to dedicate her career to worms, you know, and to the underprivileged and diseases that are termed neglected tropical diseases, it absolutely takes a special person, and I think that's who you are, Yvonne. As her biography in the book says, she focuses her research on neglected tropical diseases, primarily among marginalized populations such as Orang Asli communities and migrant workers, using toolkits such as GIS and next generation sequencing to map and understand these diseases amongst this population. More recently, using molecular techniques, she has, with colleagues, looked into the interactions between parasitic infections, in particular with gut worm infections, nutritional status, and the inflammatory bowel response. And as many of you in the room know, together with a fellow Malaysian who's currently working at NYU, Yvonne and her student and Prof. Lok, have managed to publish this work in the highly prestigious Science Journal in 2016. Apart from her accomplishment in the field of research, which to date she has successfully supervised 10 PhDs to completion and 12 MSCs, and has published more than 150 original papers and book chapters. Yvonne, I think in the last few years, it's been my privilege to have her as a Deputy Dean of Research. And truly, in the last 3 years, but who's counting, as Deputy Dean of Research, she has really overseen the growth and development of research at the faculty at a very trying time. Yvonne came just as we were flush with funds from the HIR to see that it all had been used up, and had to really very creatively keep not just the research going, but the morale of the staff going, really creating research funds from, well, wherever we could find money from. But to her credit, Yvonne, I think, has been able to put research at the forefront of the faculty and hasn't really allowed the research activities to dip despite the money somewhat drying up. And so it is a real testament to her creativity, to her ability to network, to think out of the box, to really essentially keep what we were able to turn the faculty around from just being a teaching institution to a research powerhouse in the last few years to keep it going. Along with that, she has really been able to kind of, put research management front and center to ensure that management of research, which is not a small undertaking if you want to do it well, is done well at the faculty, and also to ensure that training in research as well as research integrity are also issues that we at the faculty here pay attention to. So, and also one other thing, I think task as Deputy Dean of Research that Yvonne has done particularly well is ensuring that the labs are well maintained, are well organized, and well managed. Again, no small feat in these days where money is scarce. So all credit to Yvonne, who has managed to, despite all her management duties, been able to continue her research activities at the highest level. And with that, I'm sure all of you are looking forward to hearing the 15 years or so of very interesting work that Yvonne has been doing in gut worms. So over to you, Yvonne.
Thank you for enhancing my height. A very good afternoon. Yang berbahagia, Datuk Professor Dr. Adiba Kamruzzaman, the Dean of the Faculty of Medicine, and all Deputy Deans. Yang berusa Professor Dr. Tunku Kamruzzaman, the Director of University of Malaya Medical Center, and all Deputy Directors. Professor Suresh Kumar, my head of department of parasitology, Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Professor Mustafa Babji, distinguished emeritus professors, Datuk professors, fellows and members of the Academy of Sciences Malaysia, Honorable President, Council members and members of the Malaysian Society of Parasitology and Tropical Medicine, academicians and colleagues, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, I'm indeed truly honored by your presence today. I'm very grateful to be surrounded by my family, my parents, my in-laws and relatives, and of course my husband and my three boys, as well as a large family of academicians, colleagues, staff and researchers. You know, I met Prof. Adiba during lunch and she was telling me, you must enjoy your lecture. And I was telling myself, yes, I'm going to enjoy this lecture because it's not always that I can get my three boys to pay attention to me for 45 minutes. And my youngest boy was asking me yesterday, Mommy, what do I tell my teacher if Dad comes early to pick me up tomorrow? So I told him, tell your teacher you're going home early because your mom is going to lecture you. So, ladies and gentlemen, this brings me to the talk about worms today. And I hope by the end of this lecture, I will change your perception about these poor creatures. So this leads me to my talk on debunking the myth about gut worms by unlocking the secret of gut microbiota. This event is co-organized by the Faculty of Medicine UM, Academy of Sciences Malaysia, and the Malaysian Society of Parasitology and Tropical Medicine. It is also my ASM fellow lecture, as I was conferred as a fellow last year. Now, it is customary during an inaugural lecture to give you a bit about the background of myself. And let me start by saying one of my all-time favorite movies is Forrest Gump. In 1995, this movie garnered 6 Grammy Awards. Now, the story depicts the life of Forrest Gump, which is played by Tom Hanks. And he's a slow-witted but a very kind-hearted man. He was a constant target of bully because he had deformities in his leg. And his mom was his inspiration and gave him the motivation to adapt to society, to make mistakes, to learn from the lesson, and to move on. In one of her famous messages to him, she said, "Life is like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're gonna get." And that's what happened to me. I come from the town of Melaka. It was once called a Sleepy Hollow when I was young. And it was a very slow-paced town because you basically can cycle through the town. And I used to cycle in all the streets. And I'm a Peranakan, a Baba and Nyonya descendant. And we are famous for our food as well as our embroidered clothing and our beaded shoes. Now, amongst you today, there is a very good Nyonya cook in my mom. So never bring her to a Nyonya restaurant because she will ask you to pack and go home. So, and she is our cook on most days, actually. So my husband and 3 kids are very fortunate to get good food, and myself included. So now I received my primary and secondary education at the Infant Jesus Convent, Melaka. And the motto of the school was simple in virtue, steadfast in duty. Aizura, are you from convent? Yeah. So, and I think this is a motto that they've grilled, that the nuns and the teachers have grilled in us, and I think for some of us, it's a kind of mantra that we bring in our life's journey. So, after graduation, after I finished Form 5, I went to my rival school, the Malacca High School. Now, it's one of the best schools in Malacca for science, but to the convent girls, the high school boys are enemies. Now, my husband is not a high school boy, but Sammy, because he did his form six there too, but he's a Leicestrian. So, and after that, I went to UKM to do my BSc and PhD. I also taught there for a few years, and then I moved on to Tar College. I moved on to Tar College because my family, I was building my family, and I needed a bit more time for the family. But the experiences that I had in the two places, UKM and also Tar College, which is now Tar University College, and I have some colleagues here from the days that I was teaching. Thank you for coming. I've learned a lot in terms of teaching, and it has increased my repertoire in science, because in UKM, I was teaching biodiversity and ecology. And in Tau College, I was teaching physiology, anatomy, and human and biology, animal biology. So that sort of gave me quite a range of different field of science. So in a way, I can be quite adaptable. But in 2003, I started my academic career in University of Malaya. And I still remember Datuk Prof. Khairul Anwar, who is actually the current VC of MASA. At that time, he was a deputy dean. He told me that, Yvonne, why don't you come over to UM? And it's a waste if you have done research and to continue with the research. So he says, go and see Prof. Rohella Mahmood, who at that time was the head of Department of Parasitology. And hence my journey along that corridor of parasitology, which was once quite dimly littered, began. And I really like to acknowledge Prof. Rohella. She can't be here today, but I think for those of you who are here, please whisper to her. She has been a mother to me here and a guiding light in terms of being an academician. And we have shared many ups and downs together. Okay, back to my talk about worms. Now, this might be our earliest recollection of how a worm looked like. Don't worry, the worms are not so big in our gut. All right, this is our garden worm, or the cacing tanah, earthworm. So, but I was thinking that every time when I give a lecture on worm, the perception from the student is about, oh, macam yang cacing tanah ke? Yeah. So, now, recently, we actually mourn the passing of Professor Dr. Stephen Hawking. Now, you might be wondering what Stephen Hawking got to do with a lecture on worms. So one of the biggest influences in his life is the support that he received from his father, Dr. Frank Hawking. Well, it seems that Hawking Sr. himself isn't without distinction. He was head of the Division of Parasitology at the National Institute for Medical Research, and Dr. Frank was the pioneer in the development of the drug called DEC, diethyl carbamazine, for the filarial worm infection. He also recorded the global distribution of disease and established the basis of the phenomenon of periodicity. Now, in our midst today, you're very fortunate to have a Malaysian Emeritus Professor, Dr. C.P. Ramachandran, who is the retired Chief of Filariasis Research and Control at WHO, who had the pleasure to meet and work alongside Dr. Frank. And it was Prof. C.P. that actually told me about this whole story, and I thought it fits very well into my lecture. Thanks, Prof. Yeah. So in one of his last public lectures, Stephen Hawking paid a glowing tribute to his father. Now, even North Korea does not want to be left out when it comes to worms. So this was reported at the end of last year. And around the same time, University of Cambridge researchers discovered the first archaeological evidence of worms infecting the ancient inhabitants of Greece. This revelation provides concrete evidence that humans have co-evolved with worms for thousands of years. So you see, worms are quite well sought after. So my lecture content would be broken down to these parts. I'm going to introduce you to the world of worms. I'm going to talk about worms a bit. Then I'm going to confuse you, because I'm going to tell you that worms may not be completely bad after all. and because they may be able to be used as treatment agents for certain diseases. So welcome to the world of worms. Now, the four most common worms are Ascaris lumbricoides, or the roundworm, or Cacing bulat. We have Trichuris tricura, which is the whipworm, or we call it Cacing cambuk. We have the Encyclostoma duodenalis, and the Nicata americanus, both types of footworm, or Cacing kait. Now, worms are like a whole array of noodles. You have flat noodles, thick noodles, thin noodles. All right, so you have Ascaris, which reminds you of what you eat. There is also Trichuris that reminds us of the whip, right? And you have, this is the hookworm, which reminds me, I was growing up in the 70s, 80s, and there was a famous show on Shark, Jaws, 1975. So if you've not watched it, you should Google it in YouTube. There are some worms as well, which not necessarily look cylindrical. They are flat, and they can remind you of the leaves that you find on the garden floor. And there are some worms that we call as romantic worms. So the schistosoma. Now, they are called the romantic worms. If you can see from the picture, the thicker individual are the males, and the thinner or slender is the female. The male surrounds the female and embraces her within his canal for the entire adulthood of the worm in monogamy. So how do we get these infections? We get worm infections through ingestion of eggs, and these are via contaminated food, water, or hands. We can also get infection through skin penetration of the larvae. So hence, we talk about, you know, wearing footwear, cover your food, and wearing slippers. Now, where can these worms be found in our body? They can be found in our gut or intestine, in our blood, or in the tissue. But for today, I'm going to focus on the gut. Now, for those of us, or parasitologists, that does on gut infection, the stool is our bread and peanut butter. So this is where they say one man's trash is another man's treasure. So what you discard, I take. Now, the common signs and symptoms. So we have diarrhea, abdominal pain, anemia, weight loss. But in a protracted infection, we also have malnutrition, growth retardation, poor academic and economic performances. And in heavy and chronic infections, we can have intestinal obstruction for Ascaris because they are basically huge. They can be about 30 centimeters. And they can also move out, which is the ectopic migration, move out of our intestine. We can also have rectal prolapse, anemia, or pallor in hookworm infection. So these are some of the consequences and complications. Hence, most of the time when we think about worms, we basically think about them of giving us bad consequences. Now today, there are more than 24% of the global population who are infected by gut worm infections, and about 135,000 of death annually. Now, how about Malaysia? In Malaysia, worm infection is largely controlled. Hence, in 1983, the nationwide deworming program was stopped. Now, however, in certain communities, in disadvantaged communities like the Orang Asli, these infections are still very prevalent. Now, the Orang Asli of Peninsular Malaysia makes up less than 1% of the total population of Malaysia. And there are three broad ethnic groups, the Senoi, the Aboriginal Malay, and also the Negrito. And they are further subdivided into subgroups. So each of the three categories have six other subgroups. Now, in our midst today, we are very fortunate to have also the pengarah, or director of the hospital, Gombak. Yeah. So the Orang Asli distribution, this is the map of the distribution. And they are basically distributed within their subgroups. And at this juncture, I would like to acknowledge Dr. Colin Nicholas. He's the director for the Centre for Orang Asli Concerns is an NGO. And I remember before starting this project with Dr. Romano Nui, who was my student, we basically went to meet him. I spoke to him, Colin. I said, I want to do research in the Orang Asli. Please tell me what are the nuances in engaging with the Orang Asli. What do I need to know? What are the do's and don'ts? And he told me, Yvonne, for many years, the Orang Asli has been regarded as a homogeneous group. When you talk about Orang Asli, if low sanitation, everyone is regarded that. But he says it's not quite. You need to do a research to provide evidence on this. So Dr. Collins is in Sabah today. So what we did was to look at the literature, yeah? And we saw that the prevalence of worm infections in the Orang Asli community in Malaysia, this is a compilation from 1970 right to 2014. You could see that the prevalence rate are hovering between 50% to right about 90%. So what does this mean? If let's say a figure, a bar here shows that it's about 80%, when I sample 100 participants, 80 of them would have an infection. So this is what it means. So even after 2000, the prevalence rate was high. Now, however, most of these studies then did not take into account what subgroups they were. They were all lumped under Orang Asli. So what we wanted to know is that, is it true that worm burden is high in all Orang Asli communities? They may have different cultures. Does it translate to high or low infection? So like I said, because of the 18 ethnic subgroups, we actually carried out this study together with Datuk Mistam, the third picture here. He was at that time the director of JAKWA, which is the Department of Orang Asli Development. And I am very, very honoured with the presence of Encik Saidon. Encik Saidon? Mana Encik Saidon? Encik Saidon. Thank you so much, Encik Saidon. Encik Saidon was working with JAKWA, and he was a field worker. We knew each other in 2006, 2007, and he has been with us right until now. He has retired from JAKWA, but whenever we have field trips, sometimes we'll let him know, and when he's free, he has his business now, he will actually join us. And he has been a constant companion and a person that can actually advise us, you know, how to move into a community, what are the adat resam that we need to honour and respect. Thank you so much, Encik Saidon. So we did this with Prof. Chua Ke Keng together with Romano, and we saw that, you know, there are differences. There are communities among the Orang Asli that have very low infection rate. As you can see from this figure, the Orang Kuala at Sungai Layau, there's only 4.5%, meaning if I were to sample 100, there's only about 4 to 5 people who are infected. So it's not all Orang Asli that have problems like this. Now, it's very important to have this evidence because it translates to the kind of control measures that we need to take. And especially in the current times of economic limitation, we need to be very strategic and targeted. So subsequently, there are more studies, not just by my group. We also have Tengku Sharul's group that was doing in various communities as well. And they were also looking, observing a same trend. Now, so with that, the key finding is that, as what Colin was saying, the Orang Asli is not a homogeneous group in terms of infection. We need to recognize that because there are certain cultural practices, habits and all, does protect them from certain infection. So control and preventive measures must be customized. We must try to avoid a one-size-fits-all policy and look at what is needed in a particular community or village. Now, based on these results, the Department of Orang Asli Development, at that time Datuk Mistam, took the data and reinitiated the deworming program in 2010 based on the communities that we have studied, and a few thousand of participants actually benefited from this study. Now, so worms can be easily treated. And I think that is something that gives me the motivation. When you actually have a solution and yet there are so many stumbling blocks, you basically feel that you really need to drive and push this. So now they're easily treated, but why do they still persist? There are some associated risk factors in terms of worm infection. Yes, poverty may be one of them. Inadequate basic infrastructure, low personal hygiene, low literacy level. Now the government is taking a lot of measures. There's activities, there's programs to elevate poverty in these communities and also to provide adequate basic infrastructure in terms of water supply, housing, and so on. But we thought we could actually help to enhance the low personal hygiene and low literacy level in alleviating these diseases. So hence, we carried out this project together with, in the middle here is Professor Hisham, and we also have Prof. Rohela. The student was Dr. Ahmed. So we developed a health education learning package. And what we did was not just to treat the community, but to sustain that, we actually came up with a health education learning package. Now, it may seem simple, but from my experience, you really need to deliver it in many, many means. So with the Orang Asli, you need to be very graphic. So we had this character called Zibiru. So the Zibiru in the comic was the one that was teaching the kids. So we had comic books, we had posters and roll-up banners, we had gift bags, cartoon videos, songs, puppet drama, and drawing competition. It was amazing. Before we started this, we just gave them blank papers and tell them, they lukis apa tu cacing. So they just lukis. And after we did this intervention, 6 months down the line, we asked them to lukis apa yang adik tahu pasal jangkitan cacing. And they draw. And you could see that the whole perception has actually changed. They actually not just draw worms, but they tell you about hands that needs to be cleansed. They tell you about after going to the toilet, you need to wash your hands. So this is the picture of the puppet drama. They were very amazed because it's something that they've not seen before. And what we did was that to role play, to then give them the puppet, give them the script, and then to do it. Because it's so powerful when kids are teaching kids. They basically absorb better. And we also had the gift bag. Now, we had this, it looks very simple, but we thought that, you know, many a times when we go to these communities, we tell them the do's and the don'ts. It sounds so superior, actually. And we thought that, you know, how are they going to afford a pair of slippers? They are poor. So with the grant that we have, we actually portion it out to buy gifts for them, to provide this material so that they know that soap is to wash hands, clip your nails so that they are clean, and slippers for you to use. But the funny thing is that some of the slippers were so cute, they keep it like gifts. And so we had to tell them, dek, kena pakai, ya? Nanti pakai kita bagi lagi. And of course the drug. And we not only had to sort of just do this, we had to train the trainers, which are the teachers. We know teachers play very important role models to the school children. And even for the parents, because to them, whatever the teachers say is sort of like the whole truth, nothing but the truth. So we trained the teachers, we brought the microscopes, like what we did at the corridor, we showed them the worms. We actually empowered the school children as well. We got some of the leaders to actually join us in putting up posters, in giving out the bags. So they feel this sense of empowerment, sense of belonging in that whole program. And we also empowered the community. So with this, we actually found that when there was a comparison, those that had the help education as well as the treatment, it actually reduced the infection rate. Now, so the key findings of help was that if we do health education, it needs to be multi-pronged. It needs to be multi-hits. We can't just go there and give them a book, give them a banner, and that's it. It needs to be frequently reminded. But we can't be there all the time. So if we could empower the community's involvement is actually important because that ensures the continuity, the sustainability of these activities. And empowering the community, I think, is another important role because they need to take ownership. When we go to the community, the government does build for them houses, yeah? But it's not to what they prefer. They will be complaining to us that it's very hot, you know, you have this cement wall and then you have this zinc roof. They will have a hut which is beautifully made, and when you actually sit in the hut, it's so airy that environmental concept is so high in them. So I think they need to be involved in the planning of what they need in their own policy. And we have with us here, I think, Dr. Izandis, who is a trained medical doctor, who himself is an Orang Asli, and I really respect him for the work that he's doing for his community. So children are really powerful health agents of change. Through our experience with them, once they're given the opportunity in their simplistic way, they make a lot of difference. So we also engage with the Asyik FM, which is a special radio for the Orang Asli, and to talk about worm infection, to talk about, you know, so sometimes they actually call in to ask questions, and we try to educate them. Now, at the moment now, this whole program is being enhanced further by the student Nabil, together with the same group of supervisors. So in our initial project, we had two schools that we were comparing. So currently, we are working on 13 schools. And Nabil is further enhancing some of the activities that we are doing with the children. Now, as I mentioned, when resources are limited, how to effectively provide treatment and health education? Now, we have all these means, but how are you going? Where are you going? Which is the most needed community and where are the locations? So with that, we actually employed the GIS. GIS is a very powerful tool. It's a geographic information system where it can map out and model, do some modeling in terms of the distribution of this worm infection. So we did that with the Department of Geography, Faculty of Arts and Science, Dr. Aziz, Associate Professor Dr. Aziz, and Dr. Wan, our colleague. So that was one of the largest and most comprehensive survey of worm infections in Peninsular Malaysia. With that, we actually could come up with the map, which is on your left-hand side. So if you can see, the dark chocolate areas are areas whereby we have to deworm them twice. And in areas where it's light orange, you deworm them once. Those areas that are yellow, you not necessarily, you have to deworm them. So with this sort of graphic, now not just a graphic GIS, GIS also provides statistical data. The analysis is so powerful that it could give us a data for 78 districts in Peninsular Malaysia of how many people you need to deworm to get a threshold of 50% or right down to 20%. And I think this is powerful. Powerful in planning, because if we have this amount of money, we can then prioritize where to go. So this information, basically, we have shared with JAQUA and also the Indigenous Health Unit Ministry of Health. And Dr. Glokman was very, very supportive when he was with the Ministry of Health. He linked me up with the unit of Indigenous Health Unit, and we provide the evidence, and some of these were taken in terms of their planning and implementation as well. Now, the thing is that we also realized this when we went to the community. Many of them had worms, but many of them are asymptomatic. They are basically without symptoms. There's no signs. They are basically very healthy, moving around. So we thought there is something quite unusual which we need to investigate what's going on. Now, for worm infections, it's a kind of parasite. So as you know, a parasite, when it lives in a host, it is taking up nutrition from the host, it's taking up that habitat. You provide that kind of safe environment for them to thrive. So they need the human host. So therefore, they cannot kill the human host, because if they kill, they are killing themselves and their progeny, because they cannot live, the worms that are infecting humans, they cannot live in the environment. So in order to ensure the survival, these worms then are intelligent, and therefore they have learned to be not too dangerous then to the human host. So be subtle. That's what they learned. So that reminds me of what, you know, Sun Tzu, the great Chinese general, military strategist and philosopher, once said in his book, The Art of War. Be so subtle that you are invincible. Be so mysterious that you are intangible. Then you will control your rival's fate. So the worms have learned to be subtle. So to ensure the worms' own survival, they develop mechanisms to suppress the severity of these diseases. They learn to control our immune system, immune regulation. They learn to control so that they can live longer in us. And some of these worms can live up to 7 years, 10 years, and many, many years in us. So now, up to this point, my research journey has been quite straightforward. It's quite straight. But at this juncture, there was a sudden twist. And the twist was because there were articles that Professor Chau Sek Chuan from Monash University, who's in our midst today, was sharing with me. He said, Yvonne, read this, read this. And he came back from UK, and when he was there, he was doing a lot of studies on hookworm. And he says that there is an inverse association of worm infections with allergy and asthma. He says that we need to do something and know what's happening in Malaysia. So we got together. We got Prof. Liam. We also got Prof. Jesse, who are the peds and also the respiratologists, to be in our team to look at whether there was an inverse association between worm infections, especially in the orang asli, and asthma. And from the data that we got, true enough, in the communities that we were studying, cumulatively, we had about 9 communities that we did. There was overall 73.2% of worm infection prevalence, but the asthma rate was only 1.4%. Now, how this can happen, if you look at the immunology, I'm going to make it rather simple. On your left-hand side, if you look at the response to helminth infection, this is what is happening when a worm infection occurs in our human body. And on your extreme right, this is what happens when allergic reaction or asthma happens. But like I told you, because worm needs to live in us for a long period of time, they then need to regulate the immune system. And the consequences of that regulation then is then to protect us from some of these consequences of allergic inflammation. So this is where the daqing is balanced in a way, right? So at that point, then I got a bit, yeah. So worms may not be all bad. They can be an angel sometimes. So basically, there's two sides of a coin. And I learned that worms, like Tom and Jerry, have mastered converting foes to friends sometimes. So subsequent to that, we got more and more publications to inform us of the protective effects of guard worms, not just in allergy-related diseases. We also saw in multiple sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, inflammatory bowel disease, and also diabetes. And I think there are more data that's being churned out now. Now, at that point, sometime late 2010 to 2011, I got a call from Emeritus Datuk Professor Dr. Lam Sai Kit, and he called me and says, Yvonne, I have a friend from New York who wants to get in touch with someone who does on worm. And that's when I got to know Associate Professor Dr. Peng Lok, who is in the New York University. And after discussion, what we were interested to find out was to see whether how worm infection could actually affect or be associated with the profiles of the gut bacteria, or what we call as the gut microbiota. So this is because I think there's trillions of bacteria that's in the gut. and there are common cells, some of them are common cells. And if a worm infection occurs, how does this affect on that whole ecosystem of bacteria that's in the gut? So with that, we then started a study. Dr. Lee Soo Ching was my student, so she was co-supervised with Peng Lok, myself, and also Prof. Chua Kit King. So when we did the study, now, it's not ethical to infect humans. So what we needed to do was to do the other way around. We need to then look at people who had the infection, compare them with people who had no infection. So we saw that those who had worm infection had greater diversity of gut microbiota. Now, I like this analogy by one of my students, Chua Ling Ling. Yeah? And Ling Ling put it very nicely. She was telling me that in one of her presentation, she was saying, you know, in our gut, if you have high diversity of bacteria and good bacteria, that is, basically it's like a garden with lots of different types of species of flowers. But if you have bad bacteria, this is what happens to your gut. Ling Ling, thank you. Yeah. So it's really, I thought, this is really a powerful, you know, impression to actually explain about diversity of bacteria in our gut. Now, Ernest Rutherford once said, "You can plan research, but you cannot plan a discovery." I did not know I would discover anything at that point, to tell you the truth. But what happened subsequently was a journey that brought us from stool to science. So so science is basically a journal by US. It's quite a prestigious journal. And the whole experience with science was that the paper was published in this journal was just 6 pages long. But we had to submit 40 pages of supplementary information and data to get it published. So the amount of information that went in. So anyway, with that findings that we found in the earlier study, so we thought that probably we can use worms to treat certain diseases, but then we need to zoom down to one particular disease. So for that study, we had Peng Lok and we also had Ken in. Ken, yeah. So Ken is the guy in the last picture. So we thought that we'll do in inflammatory bowel disease. So this disease, that I think the causative agent is quite hard to narrow it down. There are certain treatments available, but I think the disease can be quite chronic and debilitating. So we could do this because Kent developed a mice which we call as the NOD2 deficiency mice. So what we did was we knocked down certain genes to simulate this disease, IBD. And in mice that have this knockdown gene, it has intestinal abnormalities. There is abnormal globulin cells, therefore the mucus layer is actually depleted. And when we studied the microbiome of these mice, we found that there is a particular group of bacteria, Bacteroides vulgatus, that was very, very prevalent in mice with this deficiency. So when we infect worms into these mice, what we found that there was a reversal in the intestinal abnormalities. There's a lot of work actually done on the background. There's pathology work, there is immunoassays, there's a lot of other molecular work that we were doing as well to derive to this conclusion. And so the worm infection, not just inhabited, like I was saying, with this kind of deficiency, the mice had a lot of bacteroidase. But when we introduced the worm, Trichuris, we saw that bacteroidase was going down and there was another group of bacteria that was proliferating and that was the clostridial strains. So it's very peculiar. Now, in diagrammatic form, this is what's happening. When we had the worm infection introduced to the mice, it stimulates our immune system and by stimulating it, it is repairing our mucus layer. And when the mucus layer starts building up, it provides a very conducive environment for certain bacteria to grow, in particularly the clostridial bacteria. And as in any ecological concept, when there is a certain group of individual that's thriving, there is competition. So the good will outcompete the bad. So this is what is happening in this MICE model. So we had that in the MICE model, but we wanted to see whether it's the same in the human. And when we did it in the human study, we saw similar. In the cross-sectional study, we saw that when there were worms infection, the gut microbial diversity was high. So what we did, like I told you, we could not infect people. That's not ethical. So what we did was we dewormed them. We took out the worm from them, all right? So when we reduced the worm infection by giving them treatment, by deworming, we saw that the humans had a reduction in the clostridial strains, whereas the bacteroidea strains was then coming up. So it was a reverse, but it's basically coming to the same conclusion. Now, we also used bioinformatics. We had an IT expert that actually developed the whole program by himself to look whether this antagonistic relationship between clostridialase and bacteroidealase can be applied in both developing country as well as developed countries, because IBD is an infection that is important in developed countries. So we wanted to see whether the application was global. So with this bioinformatics, we found that yes, they could. We looked into a lot of databases in throughout the world and did some statistical analysis. So the key worm that we are talking about is Trichuris worm. This is the guy, all right, that drives the microbial signature. So there is a synergistic sort of what's going to happen between the worm's immune system and gut microbiota. They work in synergy for the good or for the bad. Now, the thing is that I think worm therapy is not for everybody. I think it's not palatable. So we thought that, you know, we need proxies or we need surrogates. So if we can't give you worms, we may give you some bacteria in a drink, like a probiotic. But what we need to know now is that, is it just a group of bacteria or is it a few groups of bacteria that's interplaying and providing that positive effect? So we are undergoing a lot more studies. We are very fortunate, early of this year, the NIH funders have given us a fund between 2018 to 2022 to actually further this study. I must thank Emeritus Dato' Professor Lam Sai Kit. He has really motivated me along the way, and even in the era of HIR, it was very stressful to deliver all the papers, tier one papers, but he was constantly there to ask how it was, and thank you so much, Prof. So our discovery continues. We have a group of students here, and Su Ching now has become our postdoc to look into the various other aspects of the study. And so in the nutshell now, low doses of worms may be our friends, and high doses of worms, they are our foe. Now back to the orang asli. The take-home message for the orang asli is that it is still important to deworm the orang asli. And I hope that we can initiate some long-term programs for the orang asli, because it may be difficult to eradicate totally the worm infection in these communities, but it is important to reduce the worm burden so that the orang asli can benefit from these positive effects of low doses of worms. Now, our work on gut microbiota has also extended to other races as well. And we did this with some of our collaborators from IMU and some colleagues in UM as well. We also did the gut microbiota work then with some colleagues in the cancer group and also in the HIV. And currently, our faculty, we have this microbiome research group. There are various people or various groups that are doing on the gut microbiome, understanding the role in different diseases. And we are basically collaborating with different groups of researchers, international researchers. But what was nice about this is that we share what we learn, because it's quite a new field. And there are so many types of analysis that can be done because bioinformatics is still very much evolving and it's a real big scope of analysis. So we have a secretariat here which is led by Dr. Tan Ai Hui, and we hope that, you know, each group could actually share our experiences and see how we can help each other to heighten the research on microbiome in our faculty and university. Now, besides my work on worms, so I'm not just a wormy person, I also subscribe to understanding diseases in a One Health concept, not just in humans, but also in the animals and also in the environment. So because I work quite a bit with the orang asli, I also try to understand the malarial infection in the orang asli. Now, in our midst, there's Prof. Fong, who actually does the hardcore science of malaria. So what I'm doing is to understand malaria in the orang asli, and especially because they go into the forest and interact with the monkey, there are some species that basically can be passed on from the monkeys to the humans. We also do animal health projects, and we are very fortunate to be collaborating with the Veterinary Research Institute. Dr. Rahman was the director. So he was the director, and now he has moved on to Central. Yeah, and we have also Dr. Kwaza, Dr. Chandra, Dr. Vilayan, who was assisting us when we were doing our project in the zoo. So these are some of the things that we're doing in animal health together with Dr. Rubin from UPM. We also have the water projects with the Southeast Asia counterparts. We actually look into microbial contamination in the environment, especially water. I think I have here with me Associate Professor Dr. Viranut, who has come down from Thailand. Yep. Hi. Okay. Yeah. And she was really instrumental in bringing the team together. She's a very enthusiastic. She was once our staff, and she was, you know, organizing the Animal Awareness Day. And with that enthusiasm, she actually got the whole team of Southeast Asian Water team together to do this project with Philippines, Thailand, and also Singapore. So besides doing research, I write books, I write manuscripts. And one book that we wrote together, editing it together with Datin Indra, is The Parasites and Their Vectors, a special focus on Southeast Asia. This is basically based on the research papers that we were doing, a compilation. And recently we wrote a textbook on medical parasitology with Prof. Rohela and also Amira Amir. We thought that, you know, we needed to promote parasitology, but in a very palatable manner and not just about life cycles, but something very relevant to what the students need. Now, in my free time and not so free time, I'm very active in the Malaysian Society of Parasitology and Tropical Medicine. It was initiated in 1964, so it's about 54 years of existence. I've been a member for 22 years since I was a student, so I practically grew up with them. And these are our founding fathers, A.A. Sandosham, Robert Desowit, and also Prof. C.P. Ramachandran. Our society has this journal. It's an ISI journal, Tropical Biomedicine, which I had the opportunity to be an assistant editor from 2010 to 2014. It was really a good experience because we were doing it manually. And so we were checking, copy editing, everything manually. There was no system at that time. But it taught me a lot about the reviewing process and also the whole publication procedure right until printing. Yeah. I was the president of the MSBTM from 2014 to 2015. And during that time, we got together, Prof. Jamia and a team, we got the medical students to do a screening for one of the kampung, Orang Asli Kampung Pangsun. We actually got the vets to come into the village to actually check and screen on the animals because some of them were keeping animals and they are very close proximity. We also had the Jaka people there and also BP Healthcare Group that came in with their mobile clinic. So it was a really good community engagement program in a holistic manner. And we have Dr. Tan right on your far end left, he was giving some health education. So this was the group at the end. Now, Steve Jobs once said, great things in business, I'm going to tweak his quote, great things in science are never done by one person. They are done by a team of people. And there are so many people that I need to acknowledge. I need to acknowledge the community. I need to acknowledge the people that we have worked with. And it's a humbling experience because they really teach me that the richest man is not he who has the most, but he who needs the least. And I think going to the kampung sometimes, like what Encik Sa'i don't say, it just takes away all your stress because it's not about, it's like timeless, it's like no hurry, it's like you just enjoy life and nature. And I think that is something very powerful. I learn from them. It's not the other way around. I need to thank my students. These are my first three PhD students. We have Associate Professor Dr. Mahmood, who's in Yemen now, Dr. Asma, who's in Canada now, and Dr. Romano, who's actually with us in the department now. The various students that has come by. I want to thank you because you have trusted me. You have trusted me to go on, to bring you on this journey, this research adventure. I call it an adventure because sometimes it's a roller coaster. There's many ups and downs. But I thank you for trusting me. And I thank you for, just shouldering on and just going on. Even at times when I know you can't see the light. And sometimes I'm afraid too. I can't see, but I just need to put a brave front. And that's what most supervisors do. It's really to motivate you to go on. We know that there will be an answer and there will be a light at the end of the tunnel. So I've been a godmother to some of my students, a ninang. A ninang is in Tagalog for godmother to my student in Philippines. And now I'm a grand ninang, a great godmother. So to Rachel for Romano's daughter, and Lauren was born just 2 weeks ago. Yeah. And it was also a pleasure to meet the students' parents. And I think we have become friends. Because I think in your pursuit for postgraduate study, it's not just a supervisor. Your parents are important. Your families are important because that's another whole group that is cheering you on. We are here to cheer you on, but there is a limitation as well. And the parents play a very important role. I also had the opportunity to reunite with some of our interns and also their lecturers, some of them are here today. I really need to thank a lot of distinguished ASM fellows and MSPTM members. I have many, many mentors in my life. The mentors that came to my life is again like a jigsaw puzzle. Each of you contributed a piece, and without that piece, I won't be where I am today. And there's too many to actually mention. And so I thought that I'll take the trouble to put pictures. Thank you to all of you. Thank you so much. I'd like to thank the University of Malaya Top Management, especially in my last 2 years as a Deputy Dean, for their trust and their guidance. Also to the Faculty of Medicine Management, Prof. Adiba, to Datuk Prof. Yang, Datuk Prof. Christopher, Prof. Masna, Prof. Hamima. It is really an honor and opportunity to be within your team. And I feel that because I'm a newbie, they are very accommodating and they provide me real guidance. Thank you so much, Prof. Adiba and the team. I also like to thank the hospital management, Prof. Tengku Kamarul and his team, Azura, Nazira, and Iskandar. Thank you so much for sometimes the work that we need to do together. A very special thanks to the Department of Parasitology, all the staff, academic staff and support staff, and not just the present, but also those who have retired, because you have made me what I am for that 15 years that I was here. And I thank you for some of you that have come back even after you have retired to be in this, to listen to me. So it's one of the nicest department, as what Prof. Fong was saying. And who I am today is where I was along the corridors of parasitology. Yeah. Thank you, Prof. Suresh. Yeah. And I'd like to acknowledge all my faculty and UM colleagues. There's just so many of you. So many. I really appreciate the interaction, the crisscross that we had along the corridors, the little highs and the little buys. And like I said, I learned from many people. And there are many things that when I compile it together, it's so amazing how much I can learn from each one. I also like to thank the research units, the RMC Research Management Center under Prof. Claire. We have Internationalization Unit under Prof. Amir. We also have the other various research units, Prof. Honey for Biobank. We have Century, Prof. Q. We also have CRL, Putri, and also AEU, Prof. Wong Pui Fong. Thank you so much for your effort in building up research together with the faculty management team. I'd like to thank the government agencies that we have collaborated with, the National Institutional Collaborators, the Southeast Asian Collaborators, and my international collaborators. And to the research funders and sponsors for the money that was given to us so that we could actually roll out the projects. And I also want to thank the team that was actually very busy for the few days in organizing this. This picture is not exhaustive. I think there's a lot of people. I realized when I was organizing, there's so many people behind the back scene that was doing little things. And thank you so much for all your effort. I hope you'll give me another 5 minutes. I need to do some special tribute to my parents. So, Albert and Agatha. My dad is a clerk. And my mom is a housewife. And I think they have done well to bring me and my sister up. I think both of us have managed to obtain our PhD. It was a humbling beginning that we had, and we had no opportunities to go overseas. But, and this is the thing, I think what is important in life is to also use your experience and share it with the students, because I've had students that come from very humble beginning. And it's my experience that I share with them to push them through. That, you know, we can make difference. We can make a change. So thanks, Pa, me. Now to my four Marvel hero. So I have three boys, John, Paul, Joseph, and Joachim. And of course, my knight of shining armor here. Thank you for rescuing the damsel in distress. My husband, Benedict Sim. I think some of you may know him. So thank you so much. You have brought so much joy to Papa and Mummy's life, and thank you for your kind understanding when Mummy has to go back late. To my in-laws, the Sims, Bama, Ignatius and Shirley, and also my decor, my sister-in-law here, and my nieces as well. And we come from a very close knitted family. So thank you so much. To my dear friend, Virenut. She was my, because I'm not an alumni in UM, she was the first person knocking at my door when I first arrived. And in a very typical Asian way, she knocked at the door, "Have you eaten?" So I said, "Not yet." So she said, "Okay, I'll bring you to the cafeteria." So that's how our friendship began, and it has lasted so many years. And thank you for taking the many hours of bus ride to come down from Bangkok. Okay, I'd like to end with a special dedication to my grandmother, Madam Lau Swan Yew, for teaching me the power of prayer and for showing me the importance of faith, perseverance, and dedication. To my supervisor, Professor Rohani Ahmad from UKM, for sowing the seeds of research interest, for having faith in me, and for being a caring and generous supervisor. To Professor Hugh Smith, the mentor, for recognizing and believing in what I was capable of doing and never failed to motivate me. I also like to acknowledge my dear friend, Dr. Azreen Fazlone, for the gift of friendship and reminding me the fundamental purpose of being. All of them have left for the heavenly abode, and they have all succumbed to cancer. Erin was a wonderful colleague, Saiful. She was a dedicated academician and a researcher. Now, a little trivia about myself. 30 years ago, I was a drum majorette. So some of you will be telling me, "Prof, your voice is very soft." So now you know where my voice went to. I was shouting in the Padang 30 years ago, commanding a band of 68 strength of band members. So, but it taught me a lot of discipline and how to time manage. Yeah. So I began with Forrest Gump, and I'm going to end with Forrest Gump. In another quote, he says that the world will never be the same once you have seen it through the eyes of Forrest Gump. The worms will never be the same once you've seen it through the eyes of Yvonne Lim. So with that, I rest my case. Thank you.
So we now have Datuk Professor Dr. Adiba back again to the stage to summarize and conclude today's inaugural lecture.
Ladies and gentlemen, fellow academicians, some of you know that I get very emotional as well. I don't know why I'm getting emotional at Yvonne's inaugural lecture, but that's how it is. You have heard a very special lecture from a very special person. Okay, I've got to calm down. I started the introducing Yvonne as a quiet achiever, but I think to that list now, I can add, what's wrong with me? passionate, compassionate academician that we are very, very lucky to have in our midst. And she's full of humility, and I'm now going to call her the mistress of understatement. I mean, who else would describe a publication in Science with an impact factor of 37? You know that journal that is quite prestigious. Yvonne did just that about 45 minutes ago. And when describing the humble beginnings of her parents as having done well to produce two wonderful children with PhDs. So she promised that she would debunk the myths of worms and Joachim, that you would stay enthralled for 45 minutes listening to your mum's lecture. Where are you? Okay. But I think all of us, not just you, Joachim, managed to really, really enjoy the 45, more than 40, slightly more, the hour of the worming journey that Yvonne took us through her career. And I think what was special is that Yvonne, and I think that's a mark of a true scientist, a true academician, that who was able to take, especially towards the end, sophisticated science and really simplify it for most of us here in the room to understand. And I think Yvonne's career is distinguished on two levels. One is taking science literally to the ground, literally into the holes of the worms and those brown stools, but to make it really impactful with her projects and for the people that we all try to serve. And then, of course, in more recent years, the cutting-edge research in gut microbiome that, who knows, one day, Yvonne, you and Prof. Loke will crack that Swedish Nobel Prize with this very, very cutting-edge research and work that, you know, the little dimly lit parasitology lab in the Faculty of Medicine is able to contribute to a disease that really, in Malaysia, we don't see very much, but it just shows you how important science is, global networking is, and that we here at UM are punching way above our weight in contributing to really important science. And that has been recognized by the really difficult NIH grant that you have just recently received. So, congratulations, Yvonne. Congratulations for a wonderful lecture. Congratulations for your life work and, for supporting us in management and the faculty. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Dato' Aliba, for chairing this lecture. And thank you, Prof. Dr. Yvonne Lim, for your insightful presentation. Ladies and gentlemen, this marks the end of the event for today, and I hope all of us have greatly benefited from today's session. I would like now to call Professor Dato' Dr. Khairul Anwar Abdullah, Chairman of Academy Science Malaysia Medical and Health Sciences Discipline Group, to give a memento to Professor Dr. Yvonne Lim. Bio Research Group.